It's the Solar One Sci-Fi Podcast.
No pressure.
Right, well, are we all just sat in like this?
Normally you have to say hello to the YouTube audience and the big wide world and say, hello, this is episode 189 of the Solar One Sci-Fi Podcast. That's what I've just said. Have I actually started the introduction, or are you going to say hello as well?
Yeah, I think you've got the introduction. Yeah.
All right. So, okay. So, basically, hello. Hello, world. Hello, everybody. We were just debating how to start this episode. Martin was looking at me like I was an alien being, which is pretty good because he likes science fiction and I like science fiction too. We are joined once again by our good friend, Mr. Malcolm Patterson in London. Hello, Malcolm. How are you?
Yeah, not too bad.
Good. Thanks for joining us. And we're going to be talking about Superman 1978, which is a very, very good film, very popular, and to me the most definitive of Superman's incarnations, at least played by actors on the big screen or small screen even.
I do like Henry Cavill.
Which one's that? Is that the one that faced Batman, or the one I couldn't stand?
Yes, that one.
Yeah, actually, no, I didn't mind him. Right, his first one was good.
Was so perfect.
Yeah, no, I didn't. He did have that vibe, but I didn't like the Batman one. I didn't like that. For years we've been going like, have you seen that one, Malcolm? Batman versus Superman. Please don't tell me you liked it as well. Did you like it?
I didn't think it was as bad as people think. The extended version is certainly better.
Well, okay.
I did like the fact that for years no one has realised that both their mums are called Martha, which made a big point of the film. I thought that was genius.
Okay, well, that's educational. So you're both saying I should watch the extended version and maybe I'll warm up to it a bit. Is that a challenge for this year then, is it?
Yeah, it's just slightly better.
Okay, all right.
Well, let's do it next week.
No. We're doing Doctor Who next week, the end of season.
Oh, yeah.
So, as a link to that, what did you both think of the Ruby, what's it called? The Ruby Sunday thingy, whatever it's called. Last episode. What was it called? The Legend of Ruby Sunday.
Sutek,
yeah.
Well, after the weeks before...
No, don't go there. We don't talk about that episode. It's banned.
I do a denial knowledge.
Yeah, I do. I've denied it.
Okay. Oh, when I've got that time blank in my life from the other Saturday, which I don't remember what happened...
No, that weird, strange gap in your
memory. In my life, I'll probably get abducted by aliens. But Saturday's episode, I have to say, I was very impressed. It came, but next week could sink. This week's episode could sink it.
Well, how many times have we watched things and then we build up our emotions and our hopes, like Star Trek Discovery is one I'm talking about. And then the last episode, it all goes crashing down. Now, I actually watched Pyramids of Mars afterwards, so I gave it a rewatch. And I do prefer Pyramids of Mars is a very, very good classic Doctor Who episode. But, I mean, there's one thing, of course, is that Sutek was supposed to have been in the time corridor at the end and he should have aged to death in 7,000 years or something. But that's all right. I mean, how many times in the old show did the Master look like he was disintegrating or shrinking away and then he's back again? So, but Malcolm, what did you think of this episode?
Firstly, I am not a fan of bringing Sutek back. He's definitely dead. He's 100% dead.
Yeah, I thought
the doctor, Sarah Jane says to him, Sutek is dead. And the doctor says, yes, he lived about 7,000 years. He's dead. Bringing him back is stupid. Although someone online did say to me, like, oh, if you read the comics or listen to the big fiction
audio. No, I don't go in that.
They brought him back already, but I mean, they're borderline fanfic anyway.
I agree entirely.
So I don't really like the idea. I don't really like the idea that he came back. The rest of the episode, there was some surprising bits. We've talked about this before. I like to not see stuff coming, which is great. There's far too many things are predictable, and far too many things you can work out before. And so this we didn't really see coming, which was quite good. I still think there's going to be bad things. I still, as I watched the episode, I flicked between things where, at one point, I thought Ruby's mum, not her real mum, the adopted mum. Was going to turn out to be a villain and still might, or that Ruby herself might turn out to be a villain which might be why there was some talk about whether or not she'd be in the second series and why there's a new companion.
Oh yeah, that makes sense.
So I'm thinking that kind of stuff could still happen, you know, because it could be that she doesn't even realize she's a villain yet, much as Mrs. what is her name, Susan Twist didn't. And what have you. There's still talk about whether or not Mrs. Flood and others and all this, or Ruby's mum, might be Susan.
I think we're going to see Susan. I think Caroline Ford is going to come back. I don't know how they're going to do it. Because when the premiere of the season started, they had this big red carpet thing, and Caroline Ford was there with the main cast, and I thought, that's a bit odd. Why is she there? I mean, obviously, she's a very long-term actor involved with Doctor Who, but it seemed like once I saw her that, and then they kept mentioning Susan, and it's sort of come along and it's got this point, I think she's going to come back. I really, really think so. I really do.
Yeah, I mean, depending on whether or not she still has family in the future on Earth with the guy she married, if she doesn't, it's possible, for instance, that after the Five Doctors, the William Hurnell, the first Doctor guy, doesn't return her home. He could have taken her back to Gallifrey, could have taken her anyway.
That's a good point.
If she has no family, he could have taken her anyway.
That's the point, actually, at the end.
There is a slight problem here.
What's that?
There is a slight problem with all this speculation.
What?
Well, because if you tie in the Big Finish stories, which are meant to be canon, I think the Big Finish audio Susek came back a couple of times.
Yeah, I respectfully, I don't count Big Finish, I don't count all that at all.
Oh, sure. Ruby Sunday could be Susan.
Ruby Cow.
Yeah, maybe.
My
whole thing on the Big Finish audios is they're canon until they're not. Which is, they're written by so many different people, and anyone can write any story they want, which the main TV show can kill at any time, as it happened in Star Wars, and as it happens quite a lot in Star Trek. There are billions of Star Trek books, and quite a lot of stuff that's in them is cancelled by TV series eventually.
Yeah, absolutely.
They have altered Susek's origins as well. They've altered his origins. His origins have been altered. Because the trickster from Sarah Jane.
Oh, they're part of this pantheon. Was it these trickster, the Mara's another one.
Yeah.
The Celestial Toy Maker's another one. They're all part of this.
And who sits at the head of the pantheon is Susek.
Is Susek? Yeah, that's right.
He's pantheon, the most powerful. So at the moment, he's probably the most powerful entity in Doctor Who.
See, if we accept the fact that none of them are actually gods. They're all just very powerful beings. Like, you know, the League of Doom or whatever it is.
To me, they're not gods. They're aspect entities that represent a certain force in the universe. And that's what they represent, like an aspect of it. But the problem is, when I watched Pyramid of Mars, I've not seen it for about 15 years, that it's 740 Asirans from Asira Festival.
Oh, yeah, that's right, yeah. Yeah.
Teamed up and stopped Sutek's rampage and imprisoned him, Horus and all that. They've wiped all that out unless that's connected. Yeah, so they played with canon. Now Sutek is suddenly connected to all these other entities now.
Yeah.
Each one represents a form of chaos in the universe, and they're all out in their own little dimensions, but they have to all live by certain rules. Like the Toy Master, the Celestial, he's got to live by the rules of the game, the singing one.
So basically, he's just ripped off the Sandman. I mean, Russell T. Davis rips off everything. Yeah, he hasn't written an original thing himself.
That's what I mean.
He wipes out everything. And we have to assume that if we're going to go on watching Doctor Who, if it carries on, we have to accept the fact that Russell T. Davis takes previous lore, scribbles out what he wants, and rewrites it according to how he feels. I've always said, I know you don't like it, but I've always said that this isn't a sequel, it's a reboot.
I'm a big fan of Sandman, and they've definitely, if you start looking at it, the entities that represent the different aspects of something, this is what the brothers and sisters of Discourse are, and Sutek sits at the end of the table. But originally, that was an omnipotent alien from Thestor Osiris, who his own people were so powerful that they imprisoned him. It's like they've undone all that now. But this is where I'm at. I could be wrong.
But I think Malcolm.
This is batshit crazy. Ruby could be Susan.
Yeah. I think what Malcolm said about the fact that, you know, in some ways this could be a reboot if they're ignoring the original, and like I can see that. I mean, it's kind of like there are elements of it which is are like a continuation of Doctor Who and New Who, and there are elements where it's like a reboot. So it is a mixed bag, and I think both aspects of that interpretation are do have their credibility. You know, it's a weird one. I mean, I like I said, when it comes to Big Finish and anything, I just go with what's actually physically made on the TV. You know, all this extended universe stuff. It's nice. It's not. It's good. It gives you more content for Doctor Who fans. But I've always been kind of like this thing where, you know, it to me, it's just what is season 14 and the previous seasons, and then obviously the original series. That to me is the canon, and the TV movie as well. Anything else? No, it's not. And so whatever they do in Big Finish about all like Susan's come back or Sutek's come back, and you know Romana's come back and she's a Time Lord, and well, it's great. But
I mean, it's been great to have Sutek back, because I was getting fed up at Daleks all the time. They're ever in schemes. And the Cybermen were getting a bit.
Yeah, they've been whittled down to nothing now.
And it's nice to bring a classic villain back. But like Malcolm said, it did get destroyed in Pyramids of Mars.
Yeah, you see, if I was going to bring back a villain that definitely hadn't been destroyed, but who was massively powerful and dark, I would have gone with the Black Guardian.
Yeah, I would like to see the Guardians.
In terms of He Who Waits as well, if there's been one guy who's been waiting to kick the Doctor's ass for however long, it's him.
At power level, it's definitely the White and Black Guardian. The balance of good and light and dark. I agree, Suter, but it's nice to see Suter. I would have preferred him being much human.
But there is a problem with Suter. There is a problem with Sutek, though. The problem is that... Now, I think at this point, we better talk about the ratings, because the ratings have been absolute shit. This week's episode was 2.02 million, which is the lowest in Doctor Who's history. I was looking at some reaction YouTubers, and of course, never get right. The whole argument about this current series is to entice people aged 30 or younger to get into Doctor Who, right? They've basically told most of the long-term fans to fuck off if we don't like it. So when it came to the actual reveal of this episode, that the word started to change and it formed the word Sutek. A lot of these people online are like, who the fuck is Sutek? But nobody knew who Sutek was. And so obviously, you know, you can get that in a show where you don't know who they are and it will be explained. But I really think that the show is in trouble now, because it's been such a mixed bag of the direction it's been wanting to go, whether it's to keep the classic fans involved or just to have the new. It's kind of a mishmash of ideas, and it's none of it's kind of formed together to.
But noticed that still we have, when they go back to the classic series, when they go back to that, the series are quite good, the episodes are quite good, quite favourable. You know, there are people on YouTube say they're very good. When they ask all the stuff that's come before, that's when the ratings plummet and everybody hates it. They're all shit episodes. Surely that should tell this Russell T. Davis something, you know, that people don't want you to keep writing off what came before.
Yeah.
I watched Pyramid of Mars on Sunday, and I found that the writing, the storytelling, all of it.
Yeah, it's good. Good episode.
It was flawless, and it was, but that, them four episodes are far superior to anything.
Oh yeah.
In this series so far.
Which is why it's quite good that this may make people go back and watch those earlier episodes that have never watched Classic Who before.
I went straight back. After I watched that, I went back next day. But I think Sunset, it's great to have a classic villain back, it really is. But like it did get destroyed in the time colony, sent him so far off into eternity. And they were trapped, and you know, but yet again, an entity that powerful, what is death to it? You know, I mean, it could survive, and obviously, we're going to find out Saturday, you know.
Okay. So next week, we want to review the whole season, don't we? The whole series,
series
14 / season 1, which I think is a bit odd. All right, so I suppose, quickly asking, out of 10, what would you rate part one of this two-parter? What would you give out of 10? Martin, let me go. 5 for Malcolm. What would you say, Martin?
5.
Hmm.
I'm good. Interesting, 5. I thought you might have gone a bit higher. I can say where Malcolm's sort of coming from. I'm going to give it a 7.
I was going to give it a 7, exactly the same as well.
I wouldn't.
But it might change after next week. It might change after next week.
Give it a 7.
All right, that's fair enough. Okay, well, let's see how it goes. So, any other news before we, because obviously we're going to do a shorter show tonight. Obviously, Acolytes. Did we want to talk about, obviously, you see the first two episodes, everybody. So, Malcolm, I got the perspective you were really underwhelmed with the first two episodes.
Didn't like the first two.
No,
I know you've not seen it in mind, but bear that in mind. I didn't like the first two.
Uh huh. Okay, that's fair enough. And you know, obviously, the Star Wars universe, a lot of the fans are really panning it and all sorts of stuff about what, you know, the creation of the sisters. I won't say too much about it because I'm obviously not seeing it. I'm going to see how it goes. You know, and it goes back to all these franchises. I mean, all these franchises now are being sort of like. Having a lot of backlash from the fans, whether it's Doctor Who, Star Trek, Star Wars, you know, and it makes you wonder whether, you know, long-term franchises are going to keep going on, because people just don't seem to like long-term franchises which are being produced in 2024. And for the most part, it doesn't seem to quite work. Whether it's, obviously, Star Wars has had quite a few live-action shows now, and the quality, I think, has deteriorated for most of the shows. Star Trek, well, to Star Trek Discovery, say no more. Strange Worlds is okay. Picard Season 3 was very good, but it's a very mixed bag. And of course, now we're into Doctor Who. So, you know, and they're still saying that Stargate's going to come back. And Martin and I don't know. Have you seen all of Stargate, Malcolm? I can't remember.
Oh, God, yeah.
Oh, good.
At least twice a year.
So, you know what we're talking about. So, would you like to see it come back? And do you confident or?
It's like a lot of things. I would like to see it come back, but I think everybody has in their own mind how a show could go. That's why it's always so hard to redo stuff or sequels or come back to things. And I just, if a decent fan is on board who knows what he's doing and knows what he's talking about, it could be good. But it's just, where are we going from here? At what point? I mean, I know it's what we want to see, but where are we going? You're taking down you can't have another all-powerful, sinister group come in. We've then got to travel the world, face damn near extinction to take them down. Well, you can't do it with another one, which is why Universe never tried to do that.
Which is why it was very. I liked Universe a lot. I don't know whether you liked Universe.
Yeah, I never got to the end of the second series, bizarrely.
Oh, it's worth watching.
Once I found out it ended on a massive cliffhanger, I gave up.
Yeah. Go on, Martin.
I would have been in and out of it. I thought the pilot, the three-part pilot episode, was really good, and then. The sort of like ripped off a lot of Battlestar, and
yeah, it had a Battlestar vibe to it.
And because it was Stargate, I sort of stuck with it. And then season 2 came, and within a matter of weeks, I thought this is getting better. They were starting to build on it, then it got cancelled. And get that second season,
because let's face it, Atlantis, the first series of Atlantis. Was touch and go. It wasn't until they were able to travel backwards and forwards from Earth, and they had the
midway station.
Yeah, they had the intergalactic ships and all that. That's when it got really good. And that's why when people say to me they don't like the last two seasons of Stargate SG-1 once Jack O'Neill had gone around, I said, yeah, but I loved the fact they had ships then. I loved the space battles. I loved all of that. It was great.
SG-1,
the Daedalus or something would have been brilliant.
Yeah. Yeah, and the Odyssey as well. What it made it so good was that by the time it was the end of year 10, they had got all the technology. They were now an intergalactic race, even though it's... I love that.
The Asgard gave them all their knowledge.
Yeah, Asgard. Yeah.
Yeah.
Which they can't use, because as soon as they turn on that core, they get attacked. Yeah. So they can't use any of it.
That's true.
I think if they brought Stargate back, I think it should be more about... Because the third movie that we're going to make, the movie called Exposure or something, that the world finds out.
Yeah. I heard about something like that, yeah.
And the world finds out, and it would have been to see the Earth arising as an interstellar power. And I think you could have gone with it. Technology, the Earth's mentality changes, the world changes, and they're expanding out now. They're becoming a power within the galaxy. And of course, you get too bad. He's saying that, but it's about the politics, and it's more about us taking our step out as the fifth race into this.
But Stargate, there's two things I really loved about the series. There were two of these standard trope things that I hate. One is any kind of mirror universe evil twin. I always think that's bollocks. It's the worst case scenario.
Even the Star Trek one.
They were pretty much all shit apart from the Enterprise one.
In the Mirror of Darkly.
Yeah. Whatever. But Stargate SG-1, they do evil twin beautifully. They are really good at it. They did it several times and they were very good at it. The other thing is, everybody hates clip shows. I hate fucking clip shows.
They had loads in the Stargate.
Yeah, they were brilliant at them as well. The clip show where they introduced the Stargate to the other superpowers was a brilliant episode. And you can flashback.
Yeah,
that's when they've got no money left to end the season.
And yet, bizarrely enough, although they're supposed to be budget episodes, the clip shows tend to be more expensive now because you end up having to pay for the people involved.
Yes.
So either you pick clip show, only have your cast in, or you end up paying shitloads.
The one clip show I really enjoyed was the one where they told the rest of the in that bunker, and they had the Chinese and the.
I think that's what we're talking about.
I thought that was superb because I loved it when they were all
Disclosure. I think it was called the episode. If it's called Disclosure.
Brilliant episode.
Mm, it was.
And what's his name? The Beverly Hills Cop guy.
Ronnie Cox.
What a brilliant
I love that actor. He's brilliant, isn't he? Yeah, Colonel Simmons wasn't it? No, it wasn't. What was his name? It wasn't Colonel Simmons. What was his character in Stargate?
Kinsey.
That's it, Kinsey. That's it.
Great.
You know, I'm going to have to watch an episode of Stargate tonight after I'm going to delve into one. I don't know which episode I'm going to watch. I don't know. I have to see. Anyway, listen, we better go into our film review as we've only got the limited time on Skype. So, are you both ready for the folks of the week?
Yep.
Okay, here we go.
It's the Solar Sci-Fi Focus of the Week.
Right, this week we are focusing on a film from 1978, which is very well known. I know Martin's a big Superman fan, and although I was not as big a fan as he is, I always thought that Christopher Reeve was fantastic in this film. And that was, of course, Superman from 1978, a very, very big film when it came out. Had all sorts of people involved with it, so great production. Let's ask you first, Martin, because you probably saw this at a young age. Did it have a massive effect on you as a big superhero fan?
My mother took me to see this at the cinema.
Oh, yeah, she saw it at the cinema. Okay. Yeah. What did you think of it?
I just loved it, man. It was just magic. Do you know what I mean? I remember the trailers coming out for it, like a big S shooting across the screen, and it said, "Imagine if a man could fly."
So this is the year after Star Wars was released. So it was a big summer movie.
And it was superb. And I loved the whole thing on Krypton, like the start.
With Kal-El and Marlon Brando.
Yeah,
it was really good. Yeah,
all that was just superb. And the humor, especially with Gene Hackman.
Gene Hackman, Lex Luthor,
I think in the scenes in that where you just are in stitches, like when he enters his lair and he says to Walt, he says, can I take your cape? And they'll charge you for the door. It's just stuff like even the human, the one-liners.
It's a good mix of things.
Yeah,
I
know the ending when he's flying around there, a lot of people come.
Oh, I don't mind that. It was all right. It's a gimmicky thing.
Yeah.
Okay, Malcolm, your turn. What did you think about Superman?
It's always a great film. I love it. I think Christopher Reeve is brilliant. I don't think he's the best Superman anymore, although he's absolutely brilliant at it. It would have been nice to see the film as it was originally supposed to be done as a two-part film. So if you ever watch the Donner cut of Superman 2, you can get idea of how the film was supposed to be. Like, the flying round at the end was supposed to be the end of the second film.
Yes.
But the Sulkins lost their nerve and they sacked Donner and they got somebody else to finish the films off.
So there is so there's an extended version of a Superman 2 with some extra stuff in it.
It has other scenes in it. The Richard Donner film.
Some extra stuff, yeah. But it's totally different.
I've not seen that. I like.
There's a great scene where Lois Lane shoots Clark Kent because she thinks he's Superman, and she's tried to prove it to him, but that's who he is. So it's all stuff like that. It's done. It was always intended as a two-part film, which is why you see the Sandman Zone bit at the beginning that never really made sense. That was at the very beginning, and we never heard from them again.
When they filmed it, they filmed both films back to back, didn't they?
We saw General Zod and the rest of the trio in the beginning of the first one, and they in the end they get in sort of imprisoned into this diamond shaped thing, this square thing floating in space, and then it joins in part two. I always thought that was really good, the way that they were actually filmed very close together, weren't they? That makes sense.
The other thing is that the main theme, the Superman theme. Now, the orchestral pieces are some of the greatest.
Music was fantastic.
Yeah, they can literally make or kill a film, the soundtrack. Yeah. This Superman is for me easily the second best film movie theme ever done. The whole theme tells the story. It starts off quiet and then builds to a huge crescendo, which is just the whole Clark Kent growing up and becoming Superman. That's what it's basically telling you. It's an amazing piece of music and easily the second best film score that I can think of.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I was just looking at the box office, and when it came out, it actually had a budget of $55 million, but it made $300 million in the gross worldwide. I think it should have been more than that. That's according to the Internet Movie Database, but I know it made obviously quite a lot of money back, and it was well received. So you're saying this is your second favorite version of actor to play Superman? Who's your favorite actor?
I like Henry Cavill's Superman. I think he's brilliant. I think he was absolutely fantastic. But also, and this is a bit weird, although I've never seen it all the way to the end because I did get bored with it, Tom Welling as the young Superman, he was also very good. I'd like to have seen him come back as a full-fledged adult Superman. I know the CW verse, I think they introduced him in one of their big crossover. I've never seen that one, but apparently it's really good.
It's very good. I've got it. It's good.
One thing I was going to say, I always feel sad about this film, is there always seems to have been a bit of a curse to a lot of the actors involved in it after the film was... you think of Margot Kidder, I think.
Margot Kidder.
Have you seen the Ben Affleck one about George Reeves?
No.
Where the guy that played the 1950s Superman, the black and white one.
Right.
George Reeves, the actor, he jumps off the springboard and he's flying. It's the 1950s Superman series.
Is it worth watching?
Ben Affleck did a film about the actor's life where Superman made him famous. He went to a party and went upstairs and blew his brains out.
I didn't know there was a curse of the old.
It's an amazing film because he had the potential to become like a massive Hollywood star, but he had this affair with this woman at MGM or something.
And it all went wrong.
And the film is really good because it's like the whole Superman thing. And it's all part of you're about the curse. He was the first one.
Oh, wow. But I think there's even an earlier Superman. There was an earlier black and white incarnation, I think, before him. George Reeves, there was an earlier one. Yeah,
it's amazing. There's been so many versions of it. I mean, you know, it's obviously a very popular. I have seen some of the. There's a recent one with Superman, and he's got. I think he's got kids or something.
That's very good, Tyler Hodge.
I haven't seen all of it, but I did like it.
Two episodes.
Yeah, I've seen a few. I did stop watching it, but I did quite like what I saw. I thought it was pretty good.
That is how Superman. See, the thing is with Henry Cavill. He actually did bring Superman to what he is in the comics. It's more nearer the thing. Do you know what I mean?
It's
the power of the man. Henry Cavill never counts. He should have had at least two movies as Superman. They dropped him. Got a new dude now.
So why did they drop? Why did they drop him then?
James Gunn took over.
Yeah, okay.
And basically binned everyone.
What's the director called?
James Gunn.
James Gunn. They gave him the entire DC franchise and he got rid of him.
Oh, wow.
And I thought that a lot.
That's a stupid idea, because people like... this is why, I mean, obviously Christopher Reeve was only in four of the movies. And it's weird, because they do vary in quality. And obviously, the first one I consider the best one. I like the second one as well. And then the third one with Richard Pryor is more of a sort of comedy.
I really like that. I think the third one's great. The fourth one, I think I've only ever seen
Nuclear Man.
I've got it on iTunes, but I don't think I've ever watched it more than 20, 30 years ago.
Have you not seen the extended clips of that? There's another supervillain running about with Nuclear Man.
Oh, is there? Okay.
Yeah, you can watch the clips.
I didn't like the fourth one. I like the third one.
Darrow, Superman clone that goes wrong, and he's like, he looks ridiculous. But they dropped the scene and kept Nuclear Man.
Oh, okay. Interesting.
It's interesting you say Henry Cavill's more like the comics, because obviously the comics change over the years.
Yeah.
And I would say that the Christopher Reeves is more like the original Golden Age Superman, when it was all like, oh, I'll get you, and all this kind of stuff. And
then when they sort of brought out, when they had Infinite Crisis and they killed a lot of these, all that alternative universe, they got rid of it all. They depowered Superman quite a lot down, didn't they? Still powerful, but it wasn't like where he was in the Golden Age.
Yeah. And at the same time, they up-powered Wonder Woman as well.
Yes, they did. They did, yeah.
Well, listen, I mean, we're going to wrap up in a few minutes because we've only got a short one. So let's just sort of finish up what we think about it. So obviously the spinning around the Earth thing was not the best bit of the film, but it was still fine for it as it was. All the actors involved with the film, you all liked them all? They all worked? You all happy with how it was done?
Gene Hackman.
Yeah, Gene Hackman was so fun, definitely.
And obviously the music we love as well. Do you think it still looks good after nearly being, 45 years old? I mean, I still think it's a really good film. I think it still holds up. You know what I mean? Some films age better than others.
Who was your favourite Lex Luthor?
Malcolm, you ask that first. I'll have a think.
The guy from Smallville. Can't remember his name now.
Michael Rosenberg,
yeah, by a country mile. He was lit. I mean, he had more material because it's a TV series, so he could grow as a character. So it might be on. So let's assume that it's unfair to pick him because he could build the character and just go with the movie ones. Then it's got to be Gene Hackman.
I like Gene Hackman myself. I've always liked Gene Hackman, whatever I've seen him in. So I think he was quite. And again, what I also like about it, we've always said this, it had a lot of humour in the original 1978. That was part, and it was a lot more human in part three. And it was like, when Richard Pryor did take over a bit, but I did like his character. Gus Gorman. Was it Gus Gorman? I loved him in that. I've always loved Richard Pryor's films.
On the TV series, did you ever watch Lois and Clark with Dean Cain?
I did see some, not for a long time. I thought it was Terry Hatcher, wasn't it?
Yeah,
well, you can't go wrong with Terry Hatcher. So, yeah, I do remember a bit of that. I need to see that again, actually, because it went on for quite a long time.
I may have them all on a hard drive somewhere.
Well, magically appeared on your hard drive. Yeah, I've had that occasion in one or two shows. I might have. I mean, that was late 80s, wasn't it? I can't remember when it was made now.
The 90s.
It might have been. All right, guys, so I suppose we've time to rate it out of 10, as we've only got 3 minutes 20 left on the clock. So, Malcolm, what would you rate Superman?
I definitely have it in my collection, because I do, and as along with Supergirl as well. And I would I'd want to put it a 7 for the film, but just for the sheer nostalgia of it, I'm going to give it an 8, because it is a feel-good film when you watch it.
It's very iconic, isn't it, for what it was? Mm. All right. Well, Martin, what do you think? What do you rate?
Well, I definitely have it in the collection. I'm going to give it a 10.
Okay. I will obviously also confirm that it'll be in my collection. I'll give it 8.3. I liked it a lot. I don't know. It's funny because in some ways I quite like episodes 2 and 3 as well, in some ways. But it's funny. I think it's almost like a trilogy for the first three. The fourth one is just like it's a bit like The Matrix, where they made the Matrix trilogy and then they made the fourth one recently, and it was like, what the fuck was that all about? You know what I mean? So it's kind of like, I think of it as a trilogy, but 8.2, 8.3. That's as good as it's going to be for me, I think.
All right, guys, what have we got left on the time? We've got 2 minutes. Oh, wait, we've got 2 minutes. Anybody want to say anything before we sign off for today's show? Sing us a song?
No, I'm all good.
Anything they've heard about, which they want to looking forward to? Oh, apparently there might be a new version of Enemy Mine by Terry Metalis.
If there's any film on the planet that doesn't need to be remade, is that, yeah, that film is iconic.
Because the original was so good.
Yeah, leave that alone.
Yeah, I agree.
The trouble with remakes is, I remember when I was listening to Michael Caine's autobiography, and when Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, when he was approached, he said to Frank Oz, why the fuck would you make a remake a film that bombed? And Frank Oz said to him, Michael, why the hell would I remake a film that did well? And then you go, so this is, it's a Dirty Rotten Scoundrels, it's a brilliant film. Never try a remake a film that did well. You're cruising for a bruising. It's not going to work.
Well, hopefully, I mean, like I said, the original's a clown. Are we actually... Oh, Martin, okay. When we've done Doctor Who, we've got to do Enemy Mine next.
I'm going to do that next week. That's not
no, Doctor Who next week, isn't it?
Yes.
Right.
We better say goodbye.
We've got less than a minute. So thanks for being on. We'll be back next week with the Doctor Who review. Thank you, Mal, for joining us. We'll see you next time. Cheers, guys.